Welcome, everybody. We're so glad to have you here tonight. This is Bosede Bakarey of Ibadan, Nigeria. She's come the longest, or the furthest, even further than the people from San Diego over here. Oh. And her talk tonight, as you know, is claim your right to financial freedom now. And she knows where she speaks. This woman became a widow, raised three sons, educated them, and through that time, those difficult times, turned entirely to the Bible and science and health for spiritual growth, and ended up leaving a law practice to practice and demonstrate divine law. She's a public practitioner now, and that's all I'm going to say, because the rest she can speak for herself. Please welcome Bosede Bakarey.
Claim your right to financial freedom now. You've got to start to claim it now. Don't leave it till tomorrow. Just right now. As you're here, you have to learn how to claim your rights. My dad had a very great sense of humor. As a young girl, I never saw him stay in his room. He was never sick. We never saw him sick. But one day, he kept to his room, and we all tried to find out from him, what's wrong with you? He said he had fever, very high fever. And because he worked in the hospital, he knew all the names of the drugs, the medications that were available. So he said to us that he had very high fever, and he needed an injection. And we asked him what type of injection he needed. He said, can anyone guess what type of injection he needed? He said he needed dolamycin. Does anyone know about dolamycin? Have you heard of it before? He needed dollars.
Oh.
He was broke.
Oh.
So that was the high fever he was struggling with. And many of us will find out that lack is a form of terrorism. It is. If you see people who have been oppressed by lack of finances, they become so terrified. I've seen wonderful men go out, run out of home, of their homes, because they didn't have money. And then they go out, come back, sometimes even drunk. You know, I know some people who have done that. When it's time for the children to return to school, and they don't have the money, so they sneak out early in the morning, they come back in the evening drunk, so that when you're asking them, they say nonsense. It's a form of terror. It's a form of terrorism. It can really oppress you if you need to have something and you don't have it. So it was about this time that my dad had a problem. We were going to return to school, and he didn't have the money to pay. So he became very sick, and all he needed to get out of the sickness was dolamycin. Some of you should check out that drug. It's available. When his finances improved, he was well, immediately. Do you believe that lack of finances, lack of necessary things in your life, is a form of disease and should be healed? Many people think it's good to be poor. Oh, I think as a Christian, I don't need to have all these things. You deserve the best. You need to know that lack is not good at all and should be healed. That's the starting point. Don't think it's natural to lack what is good. No, it's not natural. It's not. That's not God's design for you. Let us imagine that you've been struggling with lack of finances, and a reputable law firm calls you and says, oh, a friend that you know and or a relative has left you a check of $1 million and they hand it over to you. What do you do with it? What do you do with that check? Do you frame it? put it under your pillow, lock it up in your closet. What do you do with it? What do you do with it? You have to go and claim it. You have to rush to the bank quickly. Oh, before they change their mind, let me go. You rush there to claim that money. And that check is drawn in your name. No one else can claim it. You know that. If it's in your name, no one else can claim it. The same thing with your claim of your financial freedom. You've got to start to claim it. You've got to start to claim it. You have to claim it. No one can claim it for you. Even if I tell you, oh, Lydia, you are rich. I say, oh, I'm not rich, you know. Oh, you're perfect. I say, oh, I'm not perfect. You are the one, the only one who can do it for yourself. You've got to claim it. I am rich. I have adequate resources. It's a claim. You've got to claim your right. As you would claim that check, you would claim your right. Many people don't know that they have a right, that it's their right to financial freedom. Many people don't know that. Oh, I don't have a good job. I don't have any inheritance. Oh, things are not working for me. Oh, I wish I was this, I was. And then you keep envying people. How come God has given this one so much? What are you saying? You're saying God is partial. And God is not partial. He's given all of us, all good. Some of us just know how to claim it better than the others, you know? If you know how to claim it, then you start to enjoy it. There is no good in lack or limitation. There is no good in it. It's not good. So you need to know how to work out your salvation. But the problem with a lot of us, when we are confronted with lack, what do? We start blaming people. Oh, it's because of this government. It's because of this. Oh, I wish they would do this. I wish my salary could be increased. Even if your salary is increased, is it going to solve your problem? If you don't heal yourself mentally? No. It's not those people outside the government, the salary, whatever that is to change. It's always your own conception. How do you see yourself? If you see yourself as poor, as limited, some of us would even claim, oh, I wish I had more education. I would have been doing better. It's a lie. Even if you have the best, if you don't know how to claim your right, you just be where you are. So you must stop the blaming, finding faults in people. Oh, I wish I was born into a very rich family. Is that what happens? No. Those who really make it in life are those who had opportunities, who had challenges. You don't get anything if you don't know how to work. So it doesn't have anything. Even if you have so much money passed down to you, you could waste everything like the prodigal. So don't blame anyone. Just wake up. It's a spiritual awakening. And in Christian Science, we're finding that healing is spiritual awakening. You're waking from the dream of material life, substance, and intelligence. You're waking to your true identity as a child of God who has unlimited resources. Whatever your need may be, all you need to do is to wake up. You need to wake up. Many of us are sleeping heavily. Heavily, snoring. We need to wake up. Whether your lack is lack of health, lack of finances, lack of harmony, all that is required of you is to wake up. You know the case of the prodigal son? He had taken all the father had for him and wasted it. He was now in want. and he was struggling with pigs, you know, to eat their food. That's not normal, is it? No, but that's where he found himself, struggling. And I'm sure those pigs will look at him. What's wrong with this man? Why is he struggling with us? Why does he want to eat with us? Well, he didn't think of that. He was just, that's all, because the Bible says, no one gave to him. But there got to a point in his life when he came to himself. He came to himself. And what does that mean? The dictionary says to come to oneself is to realize one's true selfhood. That was spiritual awakening. He realized his true selfhood and was able to reason. What am I doing here with pigs? My God! That was the only time he realized he was in the wrong place. And if the father had, I'm sure the father knew where he was, and if he had gone there looking for, my son, please come back home. What do you think he would have said? I'm not coming. No, don't talk to me. But because he came to himself, he began that journey home, and the father met him halfway. We all need to come to ourselves today. Realize our true selfhood as the image and likeness of a rich father. God is rich. God is infinite. And he has given you infinite resources. You just have to wake up. Come to yourself. Realize your true selfhood as a child of God. He reasoned, my father has so much to give. Even servants have enough to eat and to spare. And I'm here. I better go back home. And that's the awakening that happened to him. And he began the journey home. We have to start that journey now. You have to claim your financial freedom. The Bible contains many illustrations of people who got to the rope's end. They have nothing. And how they turned to God and found their freedom. It's that awakening, that coming to the realization, I'm a child of God. My father is rich. And if I'm truly the image and likeness of God, then I'm rich. As I said earlier, no matter what people tell you, if you don't accept that truth, you can't demonstrate it. So it starts with you. It stops with you. Your awakening is what you have to do. The purpose of this lecture is to help us to wake up to our infinite resources, to gain our freedom from whatever limits us, to gain the understanding of God that heals, to know the truth about God and about yourself. That's it. So in our search for freedom from lack of resources, the beginning is to turn to God. Turn to God. You need to turn to Him. Turn away from the problem. Most of the time we are so focused on the problem. And we think, oh, I'm praying. I've been working on this for a long time, you know. And God hasn't answered me, but He will sometime, you know. How long? If you're awake, you're awake. It doesn't take any long process. If you're sleeping and snoring and then you wake up and you're like, what am I doing? You're awake and that's it. But if you think, oh, I'm enjoying this sleep for so long, oh, I'm enjoying it, you know, you stretch and, you know, oh, I just continue. I think I want to sleep more, you know. And that's why we remain in those situations. We need to turn to God. And to turn to God is to change our standpoint. Coming to the understanding of our true selfhood, knowing that God is spirit. And what is God going to give us? What are you asking for? Money? Is it dollars or pounds? What would you ask God for? You want the highest currency, wouldn't you? But God doesn't deal in material currency. What does he deal in? Love! The currency of God is love. Christian Science defines God as divine love, spirit, all substance, life, truth, mind, soul, principle, intelligence. God is good, the source of all permanent and substantial good. As God's image, we each reflect individually the divine nature or spiritual qualities. We all, each one of us. Christ Jesus, in his Sermon on the Mount, says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." Most of the time, "Oh, well, let me seek this, then the kingdom of God can come later." No, it doesn't work like that. You have to seek for the kingdom of God. And those things that you think are so important, they're just added things. Your thought should be focused on knowing God better, knowing man better, and knowing that in reality, there is no separation. If we are reflecting the divine consciousness of abundance, love, honesty, gratitude, and unselfishness, our needs will be met. We need to reflect those spiritual qualities. And those qualities expressed would attract good to us. I don't have to be honest. Let God give me first. Yeah, what has that got to do with it? I need money, and you're talking about, I have to be honest, I have to be this. No. Let him give me what I want. And that's our way of praying. Sometimes when we're praying, we want to tell God what we need. We actually say, "God, listen to me. I have a lot to tell you." And I always talk about, in my lecture on prayer, I talk about two guys who are in church, in the Pentecostal church, where everyone is shouting at God, "God, everyone is just there." And that's what attracted me to Christian Science. When I came in for the first time, I saw that I could be quiet. I could speak with God, because all I knew all my life is everyone shouts, you know. And yeah, you shout at God, "God, give me this, give me a car, I need a house," you know. So these two guys were in church praying, and what happened? There was this one who needed $500. And there was the other man who needed $1 million. And the noise of the one who needed $500 was so much. He was shouting, "God, give me $500. So the man next to him said, "Please keep quiet. You need only $500? I will give that to you. Let God hear me. Please, let him listen to me. Let him hear me. I will give you $500. That's nothing to me. Keep quiet. Let him hear me." You know? Is that how you approach God? Everyone is struggling. You know? You want God to hear you. And there are so many in the church. Everyone is, you know? And I used to be so upset that I didn't feel like I wanted to talk anymore. Everyone is seeing their problems. Oh, it's a car, it's a this, is, you know. How do I communicate with God? And that's one of the things that touched me when I entered the Christian Science Church. I was so impressed that I could commune with God without anyone knowing what I had to say. Quiet communion. And that's the best. Because actually, the real prayer is listening to God. But we are used to telling God to listen to us. "God, listen to me. Listen, I have a lot to tell you. Listen, listen, listen to me." And how many people would he be listening to? You know? Everyone wants to just have the time, you know? The pastor is shouting, the other people are shouting. We get in contact with God in our thinking, It's communication. It's in our thought. Loving God and wanting to obey Him more than anything else will break the spell of feeling unable to have what we need. What we need is God's spirit, not material goods or money. Obedience to God means putting truth God first in everything. We have to put Him first. Seek that kingdom. The Bible in Romans 11 says, what a fathomless wealth lies in the wisdom and knowledge of God. All comes from Him, all lives by Him, and all ends in Him. Glory to Him forever. Everything comes from Him. Everything. Every good, every perfect good comes from God. Jesus the Christ. Christian Science makes a very strong point of Jesus the man as our way shower. But Christ is the way. Jesus the man, way shower, but Christ is the way. How do we demonstrate this one? Christ is the way to wealth, the way to health, the way to harmony. So how do we get to this Christ so that we can find the way? A friend of mine just visited Jerusalem, and she came, she was so excited. And she said, you know, I had a wonderful time in Jerusalem. She's not a Christian scientist. And I said, that's very good. He said, you know, I put my feet in the mold. They have some molds there. And that's following the Christ. Is that what you think too? By putting your material feet in the mold, is that how to follow the Christ? That would be a shame if everyone has to go to Jerusalem and put their feet in the mold. And that's following Christ Jesus. That's the misconception. To follow the Christ is to be Christ-like in your thoughts, in your words, and in your deeds. Christliness, Christ-likeness is what leads to freedom. When you're demonstrating the Christ, nothing can stop you from being healed. One time I was in London and I saw a clip on a young lady and I liked it. And I said, oh, this is beautiful. And I said, do you know what it means? She said, I don't know it. I just have the clip and I'm happy to have it. Do you know what was on the clip? WWJD. What would Jesus do? That's the question you should be asking yourself. What would Jesus do in this situation? When He saw the sick, He healed them. When He saw the hungry, He fed them. He went about doing good. So ask yourself, in every situation, what would Jesus do? And do exactly that. We're so busy. We read our Bible lessons. How many people read their Bible lesson today? Wonderful. You all read your Bible lesson. Wonderful. Is that what Jesus told that God told you to do? He said He told you to do. Did she say read your Bible lesson every day? Is that what she said? What did she say? She says, take this book, study it, ponder it. There's a difference between studying the Bible lesson and reading it. Stop reading your Bible lesson. Start to study. You know, when you study something, you want to gain knowledge. But when you read it, you're just flipping through it. It doesn't matter. Sometimes after doing your reading, and someone asks you, so what did you find from the Bible? I say, oh, I can't even remember, you know. That you must get something that you want to prove that day. There must be a great new lesson. Something you can go and prove. Go and do likewise. That's what Jesus said. If you really believe in me, go and do what I'm doing. So you need to ask yourself all the time, am I doing what Jesus did? You need to ask yourself, what would Jesus do in this situation? And you do it. That's following the footsteps of Christ. Doing exactly what he did. That's demonstrating the Christ. You need to know how to demonstrate the Christ. Christianity is a way of life, not words. Many of us know how to talk Christian science. Oh, if you come to my church, you know, just come. You'll be healed. Oh, all these problems will be over. Is that how to attract people? No. You should heal with your life. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Let's do that. Let's demonstrate more of the Christ. Christliness, Christlikeness is what leads to freedom. That is the way to freedom. Being Christlike in your thoughts, in your words, and in your deeds. And we can all do that. It's not difficult. Jesus manifested the Christ. He showed us the Father. And when the disciples did ask him, show us the Father and we'll be satisfied, he said, what else do I have to tell you? You can see my life. It's enough. That's the Father being demonstrated. We all can do that. As the Bible recounts, Jesus was able to prove his own and others' freedom from lack and limitation. He was able to feed thousands of people with a few loaves and a few, maybe two fishes and five loaves. How did those things happen? How did the loaves multiply? We need to ask ourselves, isn't it showing us that we're so fixed or focused on materiality that we don't even believe that some things are possible? Here we are doubting. How is God going to do it? That's what most of us ask. Oh yeah, okay, the Bible says he did it. How is he going to do it now? You should stop that question and just look up to God. Once when tax money was needed, Jesus didn't say, oh, go to the bank, or go to a rich man, one of the followers, to give us some money. What did he say to Peter? He said he should go and catch a fish, and he would find a coin. And it's a very unusual way to find money. But what was he trying to say? God has unlimited ways that he can supply our needs. We set out, oh, it should be like this. It should come from this. And then we have people we look up to. I wish I had a rich uncle that could give me all this money. Or sometimes we have actually gone to our so-called rich uncles to help us out. Maybe at the time you're going to this so-called rich uncle, he's struggling with his bank loan, you know. He can't even give you a dime. He's struggling. You don't know what he's going through. And then you go to him and say, oh, please help me. And then he says, oh, I can't help you. I know he wouldn't help me. I know. He's a very selfish man. He wouldn't. I know. But you don't know what he's going through. But God, if we turn to God and listen for ideas, we will see that he really has infinite resources and he can direct us in several ways that we cannot even think of, what we can't imagine. Mary Baker Eddy says in her book, Science and Health, to those leaning on the sustaining infinite today is big with blessings. Not those leaning on the rich uncle, on the rich parents. Oh, my parents should be able to do that for me, you know. Oh, this one should be able to help me, you know. And you go with those fixed thoughts. And so you get disappointed when they are not forthcoming. You need to lean, learn to lean on the sustaining infinite. And today is big with blessings. The teachings of Christian Science or Christ Science are purely Christian. If anyone tells you that they are not, then you better think right. Many people tell, everyone knows what is right for you. Everyone knows what is right for you. They know how to advise you. That's what happened to me. Many people would come to me, even back home. You know that your church, it's a cult. And I said, who told you that? Oh, someone told me. Don't try to give me any advice. I am listening to God and He's leading me. Everyone knows what is good for you. Not for themselves, but for you. They know that you are on a wrong path. They know that you're in a wrong church. They know everything about you. They know what is good for you, but not for themselves. Many people talk about breakthroughs. I've had one lady tell me, I've just had my financial breakthrough. And I said, wonderful. What is a breakthrough? You know, and people pray for breakthroughs. You know, I'm praying for financial breakthrough. What is a breakthrough? A breakthrough is when something has been so obscure to you, you don't really understand it, and then you have a clearer understanding of it. You're breaking through the mist of ignorance. That's a breakthrough. And the greatest breakthrough for the whole world is the signs of Christ. He said he had a great breakthrough. And she broke through the lie of limitation, lie of sickness, lie of materiality. And she was able to reveal to us that we deserve the best. That God has not sent all those nonsense, all those sickness to us. That all we need is to just wake up. See through. So it's a breakthrough. Something hidden has been exposed. And Christian Science is the greatest breakthrough of all time. What are the things that revelation of science broke through? It broke through the veil of mystery or spiritual ignorance that had seemed to obscure the real nature and origin of man. It broke through the mist of fear and every conceivable belief in discordant, perishable, mortal life. It broke through the fear of lack and limitation of all kinds and revealed God as all. It revealed that the real man is the image and likeness of God. Mrs. Eddy amply demonstrated the power of spirit to free men and women from lack and limitation. She was healed of the effects of a bad accident. She had had several healings, but in spite of that, she said, because of her deep love for mankind, Mrs. Eddy felt compelled to show us the way to freedom. She was still hemmed in by lack. But I like one thing she said. She said she was beyond begging. She didn't go about begging. Africans love to beg. You know, they beg for everything. They just like to go begging. And I tell them that this is not a begging continent. All we need to do is to wake up to the infinite resources that God has given us. And I always say that Americans too are so gullible. Oh, we want to help them. We want to give them money. So much money that has been sent there. What has it achieved? It's not achieved much at all, because that money you're sending is getting into wrong hands. People want to use for their personal. No, they get, street children, homeless children, homeless people. And all this nonsense. But the motive is always, I want to be rich, so that's what I'm going to present to them. And you know, once they hear all these things, they want to be good. Human goodness is nothing. If you think you are buying your salvation by sending money to Africa, it's a lie. You're still on the same level. You need to see Africans right. Seeing us better, right, will help us more than any amount of money you spend. I'm not saying if you feel like helping, you can't or you shouldn't, but first of all, lift us up in your thought. Don't believe that every African is poor and they are living on trees. Some people still feel that way, you know, and it's so funny that people don't see Africans right. Oh, they are so poor. The resources that some of these countries have, you don't even have them here. You know, so what you need is to pray more and know the truth about people. Instead of, oh, let me just send my, you know, let me send some money to them. That will, it will not solve problems. Because money isn't supply. It's the understanding that is supply. So if you like, you can empty your bank account and send it to Africa to buy your salvation. You are going nowhere. How was Mrs. Eddy able to exercise or claim her right to financial freedom? How was she able to follow through with her discovery and share it with the world? As was her custom, Miss Eddy knew with conviction that there was an answer to her problem, and she knew where to find it. It's with God. Always turn people to God. Don't let people look up to you and idolize you. Oh, you know, my American friend will send me some money. Oh, they like to give, you know, and that's not helping. People are still so poor. And isn't that showing us that their thoughts are still down there? And they will take from anyone, it doesn't matter. Even for some of us, the people come to you for practice work and they want to take from you. After they've explained what they're going through, and you ask them, oh, you have to pay me. Do I have to pay you for what? Why should I pay you? I'm poor and you have enough. I shouldn't pay you. Isn't that a misconception of the practice? The laborer is worthy of his hire. So sometimes when they call out to America, please pray for me, it's because they know they will not have to pay. Yes, they know, how do you get money from them? No, I can't send money out, just pray for me. And are they getting results? No. Of this period in her life, she wrote and said, I was confronted with the fact that I had no monetary means to meet my own current expenses. I therefore halted from necessity. You know what necessities are? Things that you must have, like soap, like those things that you just need to have to live a normal life. She wasn't asking for jewelry. She wasn't asking for, oh, I need those clothes. She couldn't even maintain herself. And many people are at that level, even in the practice. The practice is not so lucrative. I was talking with someone and I said, so are you making it from your practice? He said, oh, it's really terrible. People don't pay me. So I said, you need to work it out yourself. You know, that's how I used to feel. Well, people don't pay. You know, but I knew that it was me that had to change. I had to see my practice in a different way. I had to know that God is the source, not man. So I stopped looking up to patients to pay me. I realized that God is a good paymaster, isn't he? Yeah. And it was not until that understanding dawned on me before I could have my freedom. It was, and then you need to pay me and say, oh, I don't have money, you know? And then what do you do? And in Nigeria, you don't send bills to people. You don't. So if you work for someone and he has refused to pay you, goodbye. Nothing. There's nothing you can do about it. And you can't challenge them. You can't challenge them and say, oh, you didn't pay me. He's going to. No. So if you do good treatment and you're not paid, oh, you better forget about it. There's no way to get that money. So Miss Eddy had to halt from necessity She says, I had cast my all into the treasury of truth, but where were the means with which to carry on a cause? Though sorely oppressed, I was above begging. I knew well the priceless worth of what had been bestowed on me. Just then, God stretched forth his hand, bade me do what I did, and it prospered in every step. And that her prayers were effective, we could see. Everyone can know that Mercedes' prayers were effective. Would you say that prayers were not effective? Well, the success, her book is a bestseller. People are gaining their freedom from reading Science and Health and other writings. So she got the answer, and you too can get the answer. She was asked to start publishing her book, Science and Health, and to write. And when she obeyed, she made her demonstration. In all that Mercedes did, it was evident that her life mission was to reveal to all mankind our freedom from the false claims of poverty and lack. But the beginning is to know that you are never separated from God. You're always at one with God, with good. Man is never separated. And people think of sin, oh, I'm not sinning. But what is sin? It comes from the root word sonder. And it's a belief in separation. To believe that, oh, I'm separated from God, from good. I have to work towards getting there. You are never separated from God, from good. Good is ever present. And you can always demonstrate that. You can prove it. Christian Science explains that because God is perfect, man is perfect too. You are the very expression of God, of good. Christian Science teaches that God is the only cause, is therefore the source of supply. Man, in his image, is his image and reflection. We all therefore reflect the abundance of good. You need to claim that all the time. I'm God's child. I'm made in his image and likeness. You need to identify yourself. You need to treat yourself every day to reaffirm your perfect being. To claim what is true for you. When Jesus was going to heal the woman who was bound together for 18 years, what did she say to him? What did he say to her? What did Jesus say to her? What did he say? No. Thou art loosed from thine infirmity. Why that? He didn't say, straighten up, stand up. He said, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. You need to work with the dictionary a lot. Words mean more than we know. I discovered that. We need to work with the dictionary and find the real meaning of words. The material meanings don't mean anything. You need to get the spiritual one. Infirmity is inability to take a firm mental stand for the truth of her spiritual being. She was feeble-minded, she was shaky, she couldn't stand on her right. She was unable to take a firm mental stand for the truth of her spiritual being. You need to do that. I am spiritual and perfect now. No one needs to tell you that. You've got to claim that. Mercedes says, most of our students, they don't pray enough. That they should go apart 3 times a day to deny reality to that situation, whether it's lack of health, lack of finances, and to affirm the truth 3 times a day. How many of us do that? Oh, I'm at work. I can't do. What does it cost you to just give a thought, to claim your perfection? Do you have to shout, even if you're in the office? Can't you just spend that 5 minutes just to reaffirm the truth of your being? You need to be able to do that. You need to take that firm mental stand for the truth of your spiritual being. You need to be sure, to be convinced that you are truly spiritual. Not just saying it, but to know. The Bible talks about, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That word, K-N-O-W, to know, is to understand, to be convinced that in truth, God is your life, and you are totally spiritual, perfect. You need to claim it. That's all you need to claim, that you cannot lack. You have to keep claiming that consistently, knowing that right now you have abundance of good. Nothing can separate you from good, because God is giving you infinitely and you are receiving infinitely. You realize that? Don't you think, oh, God hasn't given me enough? I wish He would, but He gave so and so. Oh, this my friend is doing very well, you know, but I'm not. God is partial. Is that your thought? Change it. Instead, it talks about work, 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 watch and pray. What does it mean to work? If you have a situation you want to heal, you need to work it out. Oh, I studied my lesson. I read my lesson this morning. Is that working? He said he was asking one of her students. She asked him, are you working? And the man said, oh, I spent so many hours reading, studying, and praying. Are you working? And then she told him, when you see old age, do you declare that life is eternal activity, beauty, and joy? When you see the leaves falling, do you declare that there is no change? When you see deformity, do you declare that man is the image and likeness of God? The man said, and she said, I am not working. And we need to understand the true meaning of work. Webster's dictionary defines work as sustained mental effort to overcome obstacles and to achieve desired result. Are you working? Ask yourself. Are you working? Sustained mental effort to overcome obstacles and to achieve desired result. Are you working? You ask yourself. Instead, your actually says, ask yourself, am I living the life that approaches the supreme good? Am I demonstrating the healing power of truth and love? If so, the way will grow brighter. So ask yourself, are you asking yourself? Not ask your neighbor. No, you ask yourself, am I doing what I need to do? Am I demonstrating? Will people see my life and feel, oh, I want to go with her. I want to go with him. There's something different in his life. If your life has remained the same, you came in into Christian Science, you're not getting any understanding, you're not demonstrating anything, you're just there, you're just warming. Some of you even go there to sleep. You go to church to sleep. There's a story of a man in Ghana. He was so used to sleeping during the service. So one day, he was doing his duty, sleeping in church. And then the reader read John, and then he got up from, yes, I'm here, I'm here. He was asleep. So when he had John, that was the Bible part that was being read. And the second reader said, John. And the man thought he was being called, and during the service, he got up. Yes, I'm here, I'm here. And everyone was laughing. Can you imagine? The man was sound asleep. He had his name because he's John, you know. And all he could do was to get up and say, here I am. during the service. Is that what you do? You go to church to sleep? Please stay at home if you know you want to go and sleep. There's no need to go there. I have a member in my church, there's a member who gets a corner. As soon as he gets into that corner, he's asleep. It's only when we want to sing hymns, and then you see him struggling. And then you say, what did they announce? What is it? So one day I called him. I said, my dear, don't bother coming to church. What are you coming? You sleep throughout. Stay at home. No one is driving you from your bed. Stay there and sleep. Don't go to church to sleep. So if some of you go to church to sleep, better wake up. It's not right to sleep in church. So where comes lack of supply or poverty? It originates in the false belief that matter, not spirit, is a source of supply. When Peter and his fellow fishermen had toiled all night and caught nothing, Jesus asked them to try again. Then they enclosed a lot that even the net was breaking. What happened? It told them to cast their net on the right side. Are you casting your net on the right side, the side of spirit? Are you looking up to spirit or to matter for your supply? You need to cast your net on the right side. Jesus taught his disciples to look away from the lying testimony of the material senses and to view things instead from the standpoint of spirit. You know, it was the same boat, the same net, the same sea where they had toiled all night and nothing came. It was that same place that abundance was proved. It shows that if you just change your thinking, if you spiritualize your thinking, you will have all you need. Gain that understanding. Don't say, as Jesus said, that it is another 4 months and there will be harvest. Right now, the fields are white and ready to harvest. Right now, this very moment. And what does it take? Change of your thought. When Jesus started his ministry, he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And what is that word, repent? Change your thought. Spiritualize your thinking. Don't keep limiting because the material senses tell you that, oh, there's not enough. How is this going to happen? How is God going to meet my needs? You won't limit God. You keep giving him limitations, you know. Yes, you can't do it, God. You know, this is not possible at this point. You can't, you know. So I don't blame you. It's not possible for you. How dare you limit God? Just open your thought. Spiritualize your thinking. No matter how complicated or long-standing the evidence of lack is, it yields when we consistently affirm the potent present truth of God's allness. To admit that lack is real is to lack. You need to see the unreality of lack. This is not true. Just the way you would look at sickness. If you are going to heal sickness, you don't believe in the reality of it. You don't say, oh, yes, I know you have cancer. Now we have to start working. The same way you will look at lack. It's not real because it's not good. You need to know, see through it, that it's a lie. Instead, he writes, it is scientific to rob disease of all reality. And to accomplish this, you cannot begin by admitting its reality. Don't think some lack is real. Oh, this is, you know, this is a very serious situation, but we will pray about it. No, you have to know that it is not good. It is not real. So you are really starting right if you see through the unreality of it. That's when you can heal it. But if you think, oh, this one has gone, I've been lacking for years. I've been in this situation and I don't know. I'm still praying about it. You're deceiving yourself. A familiar hymn acknowledges the scientific fact. When all material streams are dried, thy fullness is the same. May I with this be satisfied and glory in thy name. Hymn 224. Through the earnest study of Christian Science, we learn that sufficiency is actually independent of job, salary, person, career, money, inheritance, and so on. Good comes directly from God and needs no middleman. You don't need anyone to help you link God. No, He meets our needs. He knows what we need. God is our provider and our employer. Can God lack anything? He can't, so you can't lack anything. What is matter and material beliefs lack all that is substance, all that is spiritual and good? How do we pray when we are faced with unremitting lack? How do we pray? How do we pray? That's what we just talked about. You know that it is not real. You don't start with a real situation and then try to heal it. It's just like someone comes to you with any form of sickness and say, okay, I know what you are going through. I understand, but I'll pray for you. Is that how you treat people? No, it's to start right, to know that that situation is not true, it's not real, and that makes it easy to heal. Effective or scientific prayer is the realization that God, good, is infinite, omnipotent, omnipresent, that He eternally governs His children and He governs harmoniously. Prayer is recognizing and acknowledging God as a source of supply. When a Christian Scientist prays for freedom or release from some condition, this is called treatment. And that's why you are supposed to treat yourself every day. Treat yourself daily. Make sure every day you deny reality to lack, to sickness, to any form of inharmony, and claim or affirm your spiritual perfection. God is all, and we need to be aware of that. It is knowing or understanding God better that brings solution to our problem. Just understanding, just gain the understanding of God. We can all learn how to pray effectively and see the effect of our prayers. You can pray about anything. It's never too late to pray. Oh, this lack has gone for so long, I don't think I can be healed again. Some of us think that way. Oh, I've had it. No, don't worry. I think I'm just fine with it, you know. I'm waiting to go. I don't think I should try again. Let's know there is no hopelessness. The Christ truth still heals today. The healing activity of truth wasn't limited to the time of Jesus. He's our way shower for all time. Even now, He's still showing us the way when we claim, when we admit that we are God's children. That's the Christ working in our consciousness. I learned to prove the abundance of God of good in my life. And how did I do it? At one time, I found myself virtually without money, and my children were about to go to college. Two of them got admission at the same time, and here was I. I thought I was going into practice. I was so poor, and I had no one to turn to but God. I'd read the Bible several times, and I've seen that many people were able to get out of very tormenting situations. I had mouths to feed, children to educate, and I had nowhere but God to turn to. But God had told me some time before that my hand, and I trust His promises, that my hand would never touch, because I was used to touch the bottom of my bag, you know, of my purse, that means I will never find my purse empty. But I didn't know how to put that into practice, because I was used to, when I go broke, I would bring out all my handbags and start searching for money I didn't put there. I would look through, flip through, open all the zips, and oh, maybe I'll just stumble on some money that I kept there. When I didn't even have enough to feed myself, how could I have kept money? But though things seemed hopeless, and I was very afraid, but as a Bible student, I'm familiar with Jesus' remarkable healings of sickness and sin and poverty. I knew he sent his disciples to take money from the fish's mouth, so I knew God would bless me in ways that I cannot imagine. I turned to God many times before, and my prayers had been answered, and I realized I could lean on the sustaining infinite, and I had to work with that word, lean. How can I lean? What does it mean? It's to remove all the fears and to trust like a child, you know? A child is never afraid that the mother will drop him. Oh, don't carry me. Even if you lift a child up, they're always excited. Oh, yeah, because they know that you will not let them fall. We need to get to that level with God. So, I turned to God and I prayed. Like Mrs. Eddy, I turned wholeheartedly to God. Then I immersed myself in studying the Bible. I'm not saying reading. In studying the Bible and Science and Health by Mary Baker Eddy. Many of them were so relevant. You'll be surprised. Sometimes when you open the Bible, it's talking about your experience right there. Isn't that showing us that the Bible is a living book? Why do we call it a living book? A book with ideas to be lived. It's a book with great ideas to be demonstrated. So if your Bible is just a book that you just flip through, you have to rethink and know that you need to get ideas and then go and do likewise. Go and demonstrate them. We can all learn how to pray effectively and see the effect of our prayers. You can pray about anything. It's never too late to pray. Oh, this lack has gone for so long, I don't think I can be healed again. Some of us think that way. Oh, I've had it. No, don't worry. I think I'm just fine with it, you know. I'm waiting to go. I don't think I should try again. Let's know there is no hopelessness. The Christ truth still heals today. The healing activity of truth wasn't limited to the time of Jesus. He's our way shower for all time. Even now, he's still showing us the way when we claim, when we admit that we are God's children. That's the Christ working in our consciousness. I learned to prove the abundance of God of good in my life. And how did I do it? At one time, I found myself virtually without money, and my children were about to go to college. Two of them got admission at the same time, and here was I. I thought I was going into practice. I was so poor, and I had no one to turn to but God. I'd read the Bible several times, and I've seen that many people were able to get out of very tormenting situations. I had mouths to feed, children to educate, and I had nowhere but God to turn to. But God had told me some time before that my hand, and I trust his promises, that my hand would never touch, because I was used to touch the bottom of my bag, you know, of my purse. That means I would never find my purse empty. But I didn't know how to put that into practice, because I was used to, when I go broke, I would bring out all my handbags and start searching for money I didn't put there. I will look through, flip through, open all the zips, and oh, maybe I just stumbled on some money that I kept there when I didn't even have enough to feed myself. How could I have kept money? But though things seemed hopeless, and I was very afraid, but as a Bible student, I'm familiar with Jesus' remarkable healings of sickness and sin and poverty. I knew he sent his disciples to take money from the fish's mouth, so I knew God would bless me in ways that I cannot imagine. I turned to God many times before, and my prayers had been answered. And I realized I could lean on the sustaining infinite. And I had to work with that word, lean. How can I lean? What does it mean? It's to remove all the fears and to trust like a child, you know? A child is never afraid that the mother will drop him. Oh, don't carry me. Even if you lift a child up, they're always excited. Oh, yeah, because they know that you will not let them fall. We need to get to that level with God. So, I turned to God and I prayed. Like Mrs. Eddy, I turned wholeheartedly to God. Then I immersed myself in studying the Bible. I'm not saying reading. In studying the Bible and Science and Health by Mary Baker Eddy. Many of them were so relevant. You'll be surprised sometimes when you open the Bible, it's talking about your experience right there. Isn't that showing us that the Bible is a living book? Why do we call it a living book? A book with ideas to be lived. It's a book with great ideas to be demonstrated. So if your Bible is just a book that you just flip through, you have to rethink and know that you need to get ideas and then go and do likewise, go and demonstrate them. Some of those things were so wonderful and astonishing in their relevance. They emphasized to me that because supply and demand are spiritual, they must always be equal and at hand. Again, that understanding. The Apostle Paul told the Corinthians, I mean not that other men be eased and ye burdened, but by an equality, that now at this time your abundance may be a supply for their want, that their abundance also may be a supply for your want, that there may be equality. So you have a lot of good you can share with people, and they have a lot of good they can share with you. You need to be very clear about that. I found myself identifying with the widow of Zarephath. In the midst of a devastating drought, she had very little food left and was desperate, just like I was very desperate. The prophet Elijah's inspiration was led to that widow by God, and the story explains that by her obedience to his directions, first giving him a portion of what she had, though small, the woman ended up having enough food for her family. She obeyed. I also pondered the story of the widow whose two sons were about to be taken as bondmen. In her extremity, she turns to Elisha, salvation of God. That's what Elisha means. Elisha asked her, what hast thou in the house? If she had said, I have nothing. Nothing multiplied by 1,000, what does it come to? Nothing. Oh, I have nothing. But she said she had a pot of oil. She had only a pot of oil. And Elisha told her to go and borrow empty vessels and to pour in the oil. And the oil was multiplied that she was to sell, and pay her debt and live by the remaining. Science and Health defines oil as consecration, charity, gentleness, prayer, heavenly inspiration. These are the spiritual qualities the widow was to pour into empty vessels. The spiritual qualities of oil, that's what you need to get. Don't go and get anointing oil, that what we do in Africa, you know, we have the olive oil is so expensive now because churches will ask to go bring olive oil and we pray on it and then people post oil all around the world. Oh, I got it from my pastor. My pastor has prayed on it. Sometimes it's ordinary water. People take it to church, people pray on it, the pastors will pray on it and they start distributing. The spiritual meaning of oil, that's what you need to work with. Consecration, charity, gentleness, prayer, heavenly inspiration. These are the spiritual qualities the widow was to pour into empty vessels or share with hungry hearts, thereby giving to others first and fulfilling Christ Jesus' statement, give and it shall be given unto you. Oh, how can I give from this little that I have? No. God can't be talking to me. No. This is very little. I can't share this, you know. The widow should have said, oh, I'm sorry, there's nothing you can say. I don't care who you are. I can't give to you. I have just enough to eat with my little son and we'll go and die. So why are you asking me to? But she obeyed. You must be fearless. Don't limit God. Be fearless. If that's what has come to you, obey it. Continuing my study, I pondered what Mr. Eddy says. God, divine love, gives you his spiritual ideas, and in turn, they give you daily supplies. Never ask for tomorrow. It is enough that divine love is an ever-present help, and if you wait, never doubting, you will have all you need every moment. So you've got to remove doubt and to trust more. These Bible accounts and citations from Mary's writings inspired me so much that I literally called my sons. You know, and one of them, why are you asking us to come into your room? I said, let's pray. We want to demonstrate what this widow did. You know. She locked herself in with her sons. So I told them to join me. And then we prayed quietly. And they left. But I continued my own prayer, listening. God gives us spiritual ideas, not money. So if you are expecting that someone is going to bring you money, it can come as money, you know, but the idea is very important. It might be just do this, do that. And you know, the idea that came to me was so, I was shocked. And I said, God can't be saying this to me. No, this is not from God. Please come with better ideas, God. I'm listening, you know? Because the idea that came to me was so funny to me that I should start working with my hands, I should start baking cakes. That was an insult. What am I going to do? How am I going to make cakes? What am I going to knock doors and say, oh, I'm now in cake making business? Won't they start making fun of me? I was so ashamed and I said, this isn't from God. Father, I'm waiting for ideas. And that kept coming. Start baking cakes. And I must remind you that, as I said about the woman, the widow, it's what she had in the house that was multiplied. I already knew how to bake cakes, but I never thought I would do it commercially. I could bake when my children were on their birthdays and things, I would bake for them. You know, and I loved to bake cakes, but I didn't think I could sell cakes. I felt insulted. How would I do that? What would I do? Would I put cakes and start driving around selling cakes? Oh, this isn't from you, Father. Give me another one. But it kept coming. And when I reluctantly obeyed, I got a recipe that was not in any book. I started from small cakes. I was making birthday cakes. I was making wedding cakes. I didn't learn anything from anyone. I knew how to make roses, and the cakes were so beautiful. People were willing to pay me any amount I mentioned. The first time a lady came to see me and wanted a cake, I said, I just gave her a price. And I was so scared that she would come back for her money, because she gave me the money immediately. So I said, she's going to change her mind. She will come back for this money, so I'm not going to touch it. And then a few days to the event, she called me. Why can't I come and look at my cake? And I said, oh yeah, you can come. So I spent sleepless nights making that cake. The cake was so successful, and I was able to send my children to college. Two of them, I even bought them cars. Can you imagine? I was able to buy them cars. They had cars. Two of them, they have cars. Each one had one each. They had each one, one car each, you know. The cake business was so successful. A right idea is complete. If it's a right idea from God, it is complete. I was making wedding cakes. People were paying me thousands of dollars for cakes. I don't know how it happened, but that's what I got. And the children in college only had to, if they needed money, they would, when they would return to college, they would take samples with them. And they would give to their friend, oh, who made this cake? Oh, you're my mom, okay. So, oh, it's your birthday, would you make a cake? Oh, they say, oh yes, I don't mind. So they take the money, and they call me at home, mom, can you make cake for someone to come and pick on so-and-so date? I say, yes, how much did you take for? They tell me how much they are taking. Sometimes overcharging, but no one complained. So that's how they were able to maintain themselves. I didn't have to give them money. So supply is not, it's never money. I didn't have to send money to them. They improvised. They knew when to approach people. Oh, my mom makes cakes. And oh yeah, that's good. Oh, can I see the sample? Oh, I have some in my room. Come. And oh. So how much are you willing to pay for a cake? I said, what does she charge? And they open their own mouths too and name any price, and no one complained. They would pay. And they would get their cakes. And I was making very lovely wedding cakes. I was able to introduce some very great ideas. I started that process in Nigeria where I would say, don't bother touching your cakes. Just like, I'll make a spare one and cut into pieces that they will share at the reception, you know. I would wrap it up, put a little bowl, and it's in vogue now. The cakes will be there, they won't touch them. And those small pieces will be shared, will be distributed to people. Sometimes I just say, how many guests are you expecting? You know? And they say, oh, 500 guests. Okay, fine. I would make sure that I have more than 500 small pieces to be distributed at this reception. So everyone was rushing to me for the cakes. And I made a lot of money. I changed from pitying myself, poor me. I stopped looking at myself as poor. I could now say rich me, because I was very comfortable. I had all that I needed to have. But the next thing I did, I realized that when it was disturbing the practice, I had to put a stop to it. It was very difficult for me to stop baking cakes, you know? But I made sure that idea did not die. I empowered others. I gave out the equipment that I had, and I gave out to people. I gave to people who already were baking, but who weren't doing a good job. So I taught them, I would invite them, teach them how to bake, teach them how to do the icing, and give them some of the equipment and say, yeah, most of them were widows. And I'll say, I want to empower you. And most of them are still in that business still today. Always try to empower others. Try to empower others. Don't keep them looking up to you. Oh, you got to come and learn that from me. Oh, no, you know. Just make sure that you give to others, empower others. Let them know that God is infinite and it can empower any of us at any time. The cake business was so successful. People would come in from England. Oh, we are coming home. Some of my children's friends will be coming home to get married, and they call, can your mom make my wedding cake? Oh, yeah, she can. Oh, you will love what she would make. And then they would come and give me some huge amounts, you know. Sometimes I would go to my room and say, God, I hope I have not overcharged. You know, I didn't even, because it was, sometimes the money they paid me was so much that I would imagine, is this what others are charging? But I didn't, you know, no one complained, you know. So it shows the completeness of God's ideas. That was God's idea. That was the inspiration. But God will not multiply nothing. If you don't have anything in the house, there is nothing to multiply. So make sure as you're going along in life that you are learning some new things. And the ideas that will come to you doesn't have to agree with you. Sometimes it looks so ridiculous, just like when I heard of the God cake making. Oh, this is ridiculous. How can I do that? How can I live a good law practice and start baking cake? Oh, where am I going to sell cakes? God, oh, this is not from you. Your idea, the idea that will come to you might be so funny. It might be so ridiculous. But as long as you are sure that it's from God, always listen. Because hymn 304 says, shepherd, show me how to go o'er the hillside steep. How to gather, how to sow, how to feed thy sheep. I will listen for thy voice. Listening, then I will follow and rejoice. Listening, obedience. The widow was obedient. I was obedient, though reluctantly, you know. It took me a while, a long time to really accept that that's what God wanted for me. So I will listen for thy voice, I will follow, and I'll be grateful. Be grateful for the good you have already received, no matter how small. Instead, he says, are you grateful for what you have received? Then you'll be fit for more. Don't leave gratitude out. And don't try to hoard. When the Israelites were supplied with manna, day by day it fell. They were not to hoard it. If they did that, it will perish by the next day. So don't think of accumulating, oh, material wealth, I must have so much in my account. That's not supply. It's not how much you have in your bank account. It's how much of spiritual qualities you are able to express. If you know God and you trust his promises, he will never fail you. I knew that God was not going to give me money, but spiritual ideas. And the ideas came. Though I reluctantly obeyed, I could prosper. I also realized the powerlessness of evil, to evil named lack, to hold me in its sway. I began to embrace the spiritual qualities of supply, daily striving to manifest more of God's nature, expressing more honesty, unselfishness, generosity, gratitude, joy, wisdom, and love. And when I did this, when I tried to express all this, my thought improved. I could feel an uplift. I felt so calm. I felt so much at peace. I was no more afraid. I wasn't afraid again. Because what else would I want God to do for me? The children, two boys, went to college. They had cars. You know, I could afford most of the things I couldn't even afford when I was practicing my human law. It was a turnaround in my life. The turnaround in my financial situation was not miraculous, but a natural expression of my unity with God and my expression of his abundance. I established a business, it prospered, and when I was willing to move forward to know, because it started disturbing my practice. Someone would call me, can you pray for me? I'd say, oh, can you call back later? You know, I've got something I'm watching. You know, that's the cake in the oven. I realized I had to stop. Nothing should interfere with God's work. Today, I look back with joy and gratitude to God for his unspeakable gift. This healing was so significant to me that it is my desire to help others find freedom and release from the bondage of sin, sickness, disease, lack, and limitation of every kind. You can begin now to claim your right. The truth about man's real nature that we have been discussing in the past hour or so will free you from financial lack, limitation, whatever holds you in bondage. Heeding God's word, understanding and obeying it, we have the strength and ability to overcome whatever would blind us to our right to financial freedom. Miss Eddy heeded and obeyed God's word and claimed her right to financial freedom. When I too was willing to obey God's inspiration, the way to claim my financial freedom opened to me in right and concrete spiritual ideas, which externalized themselves in an improved financial situation, and the door has never closed. Sometimes I've felt maybe my resources, sometimes I feel, oh, they are dwindling, and what do? I now have the key. I tell you, I have it. I start being grateful. Once I am grateful, whatever it is that seems to obstruct my vision to see myself or to demonstrate my supply will just clear away. Gratitude is so important. And most of us will say, no, I can't be grateful yet. You know, when God gives me, or sometimes God gives, maybe you're asking for $5,000 and you get $500. Oh God, is that what I'm asking for? When you give me $5,000, then I'll be grateful. Are you grateful for the good you already have? No matter how little, gratitude has been the key for me. When all material streams are dried, thy fullness is the same. May I with this be satisfied and glory in thy name. My friends, the door will open to you today. You need to take God's promises seriously because he means them. It's not just not talking, just talking. No, he means all he has said. The Bible is a record of God's promises to all of us. And we have a right. We can wake up. If you have been sleeping, dozing, snoring in lack and poverty, wake up. God says to all of us today, prove me now herewith, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Prove me now. Are you willing to prove God? Demonstrate me now. Put into practice all those spiritual qualities of supply. And you will see that God never fails. You can learn. And I think I've actually told you some of the keys to freedom. So you can hold that key today. Your own key. Each one has a key. My key may be different from yours, but the door will open. Your own door of abundance will open today. You will never lack again. You will never lack again. It's the understanding of God and your relationship to him that you need to understand and demonstrate. I am a child of God. Are you sure? Is it mere words? No. Prove him now, and you'll be able to claim your right to financial freedom. Thank you.